Who's more hated in Philadelphia? Me and Bonte or Deebo Samuel?
No, Deebo. He's doing it on the field.
Yeah, no doubt.
Like, they're going to play clips of you guys, you know.
They hate us, huh? Yeah,
that's fine. You know, but that's like, I mean, honestly, that's what makes football so good are the fans and the people that are talking about it. And you got to create these rivalries. You got to, like, you know, like, we're always better when we have an enemy.
No, of course.
We're always better.
And the NFL is better when we have that rival, right?
Yeah, totally. It's always better when you have a rivalry. I mean, whether it was, you know, Peyton against Brady in Indianapolis and, you know, and the Patriots all those years. But you're just better when you have, like, an enemy. So and you look at that enemy.
Is this now the one coming up? It feels like Eagles, Niners could be Cowboys, Niners of the 90s.
It feels like it.
I feel like... Like, I don't know who knows how the seeding is going to go. I mean, the 49ers very much in play for the number one seed. Philadelphia just has to stumble, and San Francisco finish. We know what happened. So, I just feel like no matter what, somehow San Francisco has to play Philadelphia in the playoffs, regardless of where it's at. Like, they have to meet.
Yep.
However that happens, I feel like we need that meeting.
Wow.
So, okay, they come out of the tunnel last week, and they're going out onto the field, and you see they go right through Bradberry and all those guys because they're on their side of the field. You're on these fields every single week. I mean, see, you send me photos of you and TJ Watt, you and Bosa. Yeah. Walk me through that from the player's perspective of how that went down pregame.
Well, it's everybody knows that the emotion from the championship game and how that went down is right there.
Did you think the Niners were sour grapes all offseason?
No. I mean, I think that you can't help but think, well, what if?
Yes.
What if?
Yes.
You know, like, we did this TV show, like a pilot for a TV show at the NFL Network, and we called it What If?
Yeah.
What if Joe Montana doesn't hit Dwight Clark in the back of the end zone? Mm. Is there a dynasty in San Francisco? Right.
Do they win again?
Or is Joe Montana the guy? Or is Bill Walsh gone?
Wow.
Like, all these things, yeah. What if? You know, and so that was the premise for the show. So
I
what
like
if
that.
Brock Purdy...
Like
what if Brock Purdy doesn't have his elbow just, you know, maligned the way he did?
Who's the running back in Cleveland? Was it not Ernest Biner, but was it Ernest Biner?
Mack,
who fumbled against Denver.
Yeah.
At the 2-yard line going into the end zone.
John Elway.
Right.
You know, like, all those, like, so wow, you could, like, come up with these concepts or these questions. What if, you know, so I feel like that's what it was. What if Brock didn't have this weird injury on the sixth play.
Well, he was yelling, he's got Ayuk. He's got Ayuk. Can we see Ayuk run the post corner?
Oh, yeah.
I'm thinking, oh, that's a big chunk.
I mean, literally, 1 second more, and he's got Ayuk on the 7 cut.
The what if is interesting because I read this book. It's called The Catch. Mm-hmm. And it you get the Niner viewpoint, and you get the Cowboy viewpoint.
Totally.
And the Cowboys go back to the NFC Championship game the very next year, and Danny White's talking about what his career could have been like.
I was there.
You know, and
it was my rookie year.
Yeah, and so, like, anyway, the point that I'm getting at is that Tom Landry still believed till his dying day they should have won that game, and they shouldn't have fumbled after the Eric Wright horse collar and everything. And it's crazy how thin the margins are in sports.
Yeah.
You know, I think about this all the time. What if Kaepernick connects with Crabtree?
Right. Yep.
What if they run Frank Gore? What if they get a stop? What if they beat Kansas City and Patrick Mahomes?
What if DeKwaski Tart catches the pass in the 2021 NFC Championship game in
LA? I mean, it comes down to a play in a lot of these games. And the outcomes, like, one coach and one team and one, you know, one goes in one direction, the other goes in the other direction, and it's just the nature of the whole thing.
Yeah, it really is. You know, it's I'm looking at the defensive side of the ball for the 49ers right now, and it feels like to me we're not talking enough about how great this defense is. The secondary adjustment to take Isaiah Oliver off the field, put Deamon Lenore into the slot, bring Ambry Thomas out on the field. You're getting the best of Ambry Thomas. I didn't even know he could do any of this. Charvarius Ward has elevated his game. It feels like that has changed their defense. Mm-hmm. What have you seen on the film?
Well, I think it's changed because now they play, I think they've been primarily a zone team. Look, if you come out in a 3x2 set in this league right now, one half the field is going to be a zone coverage, it's going to be, you know, cover two, and the other is going to be primarily a man. And so, you know, San Francisco's good. Fred and Dre, like, they switch responsibilities in what they do so that you can't put A.J. Brown on the three receiver side inside and run him against your third corner or fourth corner. So what Lenore has done is they have now believed that they can play you man-to-man more than they did. And so we can blitz Fred Warner, you know, take him out of the middle. And he loves to do that. He loves running those twist stunts with Nick or somebody up front. And he loves to be that fifth guy chasing the quarterback and getting in there. He's really good at it. And he's got a variety of moves. And so you can play man behind it. And last week, they played a lot of man. And the Eagles didn't run good routes against it because I don't think they anticipated it. And there was really no place for Jalen to go a lot of times.
All right, Brian and Baldinger live in studio, presented by our proud partner, Go to State, serving the Bay Area for three generations. Building better starts with Go to State. When you succeed, we succeed. Visit GoToStateLumber.com. You are listening to 95.7 The Game, KGMG FM and AC1 San Francisco, always live on the free Odyssey app. Download the Odyssey app, your favorite 95.7 The Game, for the best and most up-to-date sports coverage. And do not forget that you could also watch us every single day on our YouTube and Twitch streams. Just log on and search 95.7 The Game. Be sure to like and subscribe to the channel while you are there. It is a Football Friday brought to you by First Five California. To learn four things you could do to overcome toxic stress, go to firstfivecalifornia.com. Line them up the calls. Let's go ahead and open up the lines here. 888-957-9570. I do want to get to Fred Warner, but real quick, Baldy, does Logan Ryan have anything left? The Niners just signed him. Mm-hmm. He's a longtime corner in this league, played at a high level. Anything left with Logan Ryan?
I don't know what he has left because he's been bouncing around to a lot of teams, but he's going to have a veteran presence. He's going to fit in. He knows the game. You can't sometimes have enough of those guys like in the stable if you need them. And he's dependable and he's been a pro. So what can he run the same as he did, you know, years ago? Probably not, but he's got, you know, experience. Yeah, they have an old saying about experience. By the time you get enough of it, sometimes you're too old to enjoy it. Like, we'll find out if he has enough left really enjoy.
My 88-year-old grandfather always says, you know, if you don't get around to it, you won't live long enough to get to it.
Right.
That's his little move now, so he always wants to get around to those things. Baldy, I'm going to set us off, okay? And we can still go back to football. You can ask Baldy anything.
Let's get Fred Warner, because I got to make my case for DPOY.
I've got something outside the box I wanted to break down.
Because Fred Warner, DPOY, the first game of the season, even in the training camp, we interviewed Fred Warner. I said, you know, Shasky, this may be the year where he goes on his DPOY campaign. This could be the year. Now, I know sack numbers gets everybody voting and whatnot. T.J. Watt has been special in Pittsburgh. Miles Garrett's been special in Cleveland. But Fred Warner, from the minute they touched down in Pittsburgh, and he laid that smack down on Najee Harris, and we could hear that hit. You were there. You were here. It changed the entire sideline. Changed the entire Pittsburgh knew at that point. It was like, we're not winning this football game. Can Fred Warner actually win that award? Like, that's – I know we talk Brock Purdy MVP, and I always say, oh, I don't care about MVP. But I do want Fred Warner to get his due.
He can win it. They have to expand their thought process about what is a defensive player of the year. Like, it can't be just T.J. Watt getting 20 sacks or somebody. You know, I mean, it's got to be more than that. He never comes off the field. He plays every play, every snap, every week. And he plays, like, he has separated himself. There's Roquan Smith. There's guys that can play middle linebacker in this league. But I believe he has separated himself from everybody else. Like, I think he's literally in a category by himself. There was a time Bobby Wagner.
Right.
And you could put a couple guys in the conversation with him. But I don't think you can do that anymore.
You know, it's interesting you bring up Roquan. Roquan's a really good player. But when I see him, and he's a freak athlete, it's more lumbering than Fred. Fred's fluidity as an athlete in the middle of the field is almost unmatched.
Well, they play a completely different defense in Baltimore than they do in San Francisco. I mean, Roquan has got tremendous speed. But, you know, Fred, just the level of intensity that he plays with and how quickly he sees things. Like, I feel like they almost need to get, in order to really sell Fred as defensive player of the year, you need to mic him up and just see how much he says and how much he has to do every single play.
Who's your favorite player on that defense?
Fred.
By far.
Yeah. You heard what he said earlier. He said he gets joy. Baldy gets joy watching Fred.
Yeah, Fred just plays the game with such a smile on his face and a joy. And it's just the way that he carries himself. Like,
I feel like you loved him from day one when he played in Minnesota, wearing number 48 in the Green Dot helmet.
I'll never forget the conversation. So I was doing the game in Minnesota, and it's Fred's first game, and John Lynch is down on the field. And I said, because who was the kid from Alabama?
Reuben Foster.
Reuben. So they had Reuben. So I go, so, you know, Reuben had a big hype.
Yeah.
A lot of stuff, right?
Big hits.
I think he just got signed, by the way.
So Miami Dolphins.
He
did. Yeah.
He just got signed. I'm going to see him Monday night. Yeah. So anyways, you know, Reuben had all the hype, but Fred was his third round pick out of BYU. So I just said to John, like, what do you see from Fred? And he goes, he's our Mike. I go, he's your Mike. Like, he's not your Will. Like, he goes, no, he's our Mike. He calls our signal. I go, how quickly did you realize that? He goes, literally the first day he came. The first day. They recognized it, and he's been the leader from the very first day that John Lynch drafted him.
Wow. Incredible there.
Could Patrick Willis play in this era?
Yeah. Yeah, Patrick Willis could still play.
I'm just curious.
He's a three-down linebacker.
I know, but like, you know, the way the game was set up back then, it was a little different. Like, you think his game would evolve beautifully? Because that's the gold standard here. Patrick Willis.
Yeah, I mean, there was, like, this is Fred's sixth year. And, you know, Patrick played 8 years, and he was six, like, all-pro
years.
Yes,
all-world.
All-world, you know, until the injury, whatever. So, he should be a Hall of Fame player.
I agree.
He should be a Hall of Fame player.
Keekley's going to get in. Why not him one day? But no, Patrick Willis is a special player.
Keekley stole Bowman's defense.